All right. You may be seated, Israel. Hallelujah. Greetings to all of our friends and listeners, wherever you're listening from. The riches of Yon Yoshua rest upon you all on this precious day he has granted unto us to enter into the Beyant, to hear of his profound utterance, that his voice speaks unto us. And his voice speaks unto us by the simplicity of Torah, that we may understand all that he commands. And then there is a delight in obeying what he instructs us in. As I was kneeling last night, I was tired yesterday because I labored in the garden basically all day. My body was dehydrated because my early rising, I participated in an event that kind of sapped my water supply. And so I felt that tremendously yesterday in the garden. But as we were praying yesterday, the little ones, I often ask them to pray for me, to lay hands on my head, because their prayer is innocent. When they make pala unto Yah, it's not to be seen or to be recognized. Their little prayers are innocent. And as we were bowing on our knees yesterday, little Chotzeria, she began to pray, and she says, Abba Yah, our precious Father, Yeshua's mighty name, I pray for us all, Yisrael, that we are able to hear what Reach says and receive the correction with understanding. I am like, what does she understand about Yah's correction, and that we receive the counsel? But we must receive the counsel of Yah Yisrael, because it's vitally important unto us for our growth, our strength, and for us to mature to the level that he can entrust us with the abundance of his riches. To whom much is given, much is required. To whom little is given, that one loves not as profound as the one who much is forgiven for that one. As I said to us on last Shabbat, I want to continue on the teaching, but I want to teach, there is a teaching that is, it has this inroads as to what is pronounced as the second Passover or Pesach Sheni, the second one. And so we must understand that man will base doctrines and teachings, and they try to substantiate it by a verse, a chatuv, or collectively a few scriptures. So we must search the Torah and to find if this is a substantiated doctrine according to Torah, or it is something that man has made up in his delusion of his mind. If it is, then we must follow pursuit of what Yah commands us. I want to begin, you that have joined us on this Kitvei Imat, Scripture Truth. Greetings in Yahshua's mighty name. We do pray that Yah's riches rest upon you and all those that are gathered with you for this teaching on this Kitvei Imat, and that it may bless you richly. I want to begin here in the book of Bereish, of Bimitzbar, Numbers. I want you to hear me, Yisraya, because it's going to take quite a time. I want to start early. I want you to be enriched by this teaching. I want you to understand, because there are those that can confront you by issues that you're not able to answer. You're not able to respond to what they say. You have no answer to their questions. So I want to begin here in the book of Numbers, Bimitbar chapter 9. I want to begin verse 1. It says, and Almighty Yahweh, he spoke to Moshe, he spoke to him in the Bimitzbar, in the wilderness of Sinai, in the wilderness of Sinai. He spoke to him and said, in the first or the Rishon, in the first month of the second year, I want you to understand this was the second year that they had come out of the bondage of Mitzrayim. He said, in the second year where you come out of the land of Mitzrayim, saying, he said, I want you to let the children of Yisrael also, He uses the words asa. I want them also to keep. I want them to fashion themselves according to the testimony of the Pesach, what I brought you forth out of Israel. He said, I want them to keep the Pesach, the feast, at its moed, or the time that is appointed. He gives reference as to the time in the 14th day of this month at Erev, at evening, when the sun has gone down, when the night is upon us. He says, you shall asav, you shall fashion yourself according to that testimony. You shall keep it in its appointed season, according to all the hukah, all the statutes. You must understand the statutes of cleansing and washing and purification. It had to be kept that way. And so it is today. It must be kept by the same washing. It must be kept by the same statutes that were commanded. He says the statutes according to it, and according to all, not some, but all the judgment be made. Bar Numbers chapter 9, verse 3. According to all the judgment, according to all the ways thereof. And again, he reaffirmed that you shall asa, you shall keep the Pesach. There were washings and cleansing and purification before one could even become a partaker of the Pesach. Even Shaul tells us in the book of Corinthians, there are those that have become partakers of this, and they are not clean. And so because of that, you have those that are sickly and those that are dead. Verse 5 of Numbers, and they kept, it says that they saw the Pesach on the 14th day of the first month at evening in the wilderness of Sinai, according to all that Yah commanded Moshe, so did the children of Israel. They had to keep it according to every aspect that Yah commands us. And we must do all the commandments according to every aspect that He commands us, Israel. Listen what it says in verse 6. It said, but there were certain men, there were those who were defiled, they were tamei, they were unclean. Their hearts, their minds were not clean according to the statutes of the Torah. They were unclean, they were tamei, they were unclean. They were defiled by the dead body of a son of man. They had touched a body. And there was a seven-day purification period whereby when one went outside of the ordinance of death, of the Torah of death, then they had to separate themselves or become pure in order to be partakers of the truth or the of the covenant truth of Almighty Yahweh. That they could not keep the Pesach on that day. And they came before Moshe and Aharon on that day. They could not keep the Pesach because they were unclean. That's why we must examine ourselves continuously, Yisrael, and see if there be any leaven in our hearts, any matzah in us that cause us to become defiled, and we know that we're doing things that are not appropriate before Yah, and we know that we have constituted things that are not according to Torah, that we must examine ourselves and make sure that our hearts are pure. And there is a process. There's a process of Torah, of the washing and the cleansing, how why one could be a partaker. Hear this now in verse 7. And those men said to him, we are defiled by the dead man's body. Wherefore are we kept back? We cannot be partakers, that we may not offer the korban, the offering of pleasing, or our obligation unto Almighty Yah. We can't even come near the altar of our Abba. We cannot offer our korban of Yah in its his appointed season among the children of Israel. They were unclean. They could not offer the offering or the korban, the offering of dedication unto Yah at the altar. They could not come to the altar of Almighty Yah. But Yeshua HaMashiach has granted us that power to come to the altar of Yah and confess our sins that we may be cleansed. Now there are those that will utilize this and teach a teaching that there is a second Pesach. Now, if that is a validity, then as we look at Torah tonight, then there's a second to all of the Mo'adim, the feast days of Yah. All right? I want to examine this, though, concerning the uncleanness of the man, as we are unclean. Shaul says in Ephesians, in the book of Ephesians, chapter 2, verse 1. He says here to Yisra'iah, And you has he made, who Yisra'iah, who has made, Yahshua HaMashiach has made alive. It is the living Torah of Yah that caused us to have the high, the life, the quickening power of Almighty Yah, who were dead in the trespasses of your sins. We were dead in the trespasses of our sin, just like these certain men. And they said, can we keep the Pesach of Almighty Yah? And Aharon and Moses said, we shall inquire of Almighty Yah, and he shall answer. Is not Yahshua HaMashiach the living Torah of Yah? Is he not the word of Yah made flesh? Or do we not find the answer in Yahshua HaMashiach? Then we must search from Bereshit to Jitzu or Gilyana to find the answer. Also, it says here in the book of 1 Peter, Kepha, 1 Peter, chapter 1, verse 22. This is how we purify ourselves, not by the washing of the pots in the bed of Yah. We are washed by the pure word of Yah. It is the pure word that washes us. 1 Peter 1:22, Kepha says to Yisra'iah, seeing you have purified, you have tahor, made yourself clean, your nefesh, how? First of all, in obeying the Torah, you obey the truth. We must asah, we must keep the Pesach of Yah. We must keep it at the appointed time. This allude even to those certain men, to the event or the advent of the coming of Yahshua HaMashiach. It is the power of that living word that cleanses us. That is why our flesh constantly fight against it. Well, we have obeyed the truth of Yah through the Ruach, through the life of his living testimony in Yahshua, to unfeign love that is not phony or superficial or hypocrisy, to unfeign ahava of the Yisraelites, or the fellowship with brotherly kindness, Yisra'iah, and we have love ahava one toward the other fervently. We can see that. We can see that in the example of Moshe and Aharon, because these men knew that to offer up their korban there, to come before the altar and offer the gift of Todah unto Yah for this great testimony, that their hands had to be cleansed. And our hands must be cleansed. And our hands are cleansed because we can lift them up to the heavens, as Azarkain commanded us, because we have obeyed the Torah of Yah. He would that men everywhere lift up hands that are kadosh, clean, hands that are unspotted. And you're not going to do that by washing in some liquid mayam or the liquid mayam. It must be the living water. And Yahshua is that living water. It must come that way. We have obeyed. We have purified our mind, made it right. Although we touch the dead body, and although the death of our sins and the trespassings of our sins, we were dead in the trespasses of our sins, it is Yahshua HaMashiach that has cleansed us. And so we can now boldly approach the altar of Yah and offer up his gift even on Pesach, although we sin the hour before we entered into the house of Yah. I will prove it out. They were only in the second year of this great captivity that they were brought out. They didn't understand the nuances of the statutes of Almighty Yahweh, just like we do not understand the nuances of Yahshua HaMashiach. But we know that he is the truth of Yah. And every word that he spoke to us is truth. He gives us great consolation here in the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter 1 verse 5. Revelation chapter 1 verse 5. It says, and from Yahshua HaMashiach, who is the faithful witness. He is the Eduth. He is the witness of Yah. He is the witness only of the power of Yah's truth. He says the first, that's who he is. He is the first begotten of the dead. He is the prince of the kings of the earth. To him, to Almighty Yah, to him that loved us, and he washed us from our sins by the power of the blood of Yahshua HaMashiach. And so those certain men, they needed the cleansing. It had to come by the order of the Torah that they were cleansed. And they wanted to be a part of Pesach, the offering of their Korban, the offering of Todah and praises unto Yah. And yet, they were not cleansed according to the Torah of Moshe. But this is the Torah of Moshe. It preludes to the event of the coming of Yahshua HaMashiach. And we are washed in his dam. We are washed in the dam, the blood of Yahshua HaMashiach. We are cleansed from our sin. He is the prince of all kings. He is the Tsar of all rulers, Yisrael. And so we can come and present our korban, our offering unto him for this most dynamic testimony. There are those that say that there is a second Pesach. Hear the word of Yah. It says again in Numbers, back to Bimidbar, Numbers chapter 9, verse 7. And those men said to him, we are defiled by the body of a dead Adam. Wherefore we are kept back, that we may not offer an korban, our oblation, near the altar of Yah in his appointed season among the children of Israel. And Moshe said to them, stand still, I will hear what Yah commands concerning this hour. I will hear. Now there is no reason why we should not be cleansed on Pesach. One says to me, as one called me about this matter, I say, you are wrong. And one got very verbal about it. I said, let me show you what Yah was trying to imply. Although he was permissive of that, when one has what we call a birthday, and they celebrate their birthday on April 17th, so all of their friends do not get to town until the 21st, that doesn't mean that that's the one's birthday they're celebrating, but they do celebrate it again. And they do have the decor of celebrating, we're celebrating your birthday. That's what they will do. And this is what Yah, this is the principle of what was applied here. They were unclean, but yet their hearts were sincere and they were pure before Yah. So if a man's heart is sincere, what sin can we sin that the dam of Yahshua cannot cleanse? It's not a process of weeks or days of hours. It is confessing our faults, our sins before Yah, and he washes and cleanses from all of our filth. Moshe says, stand still, I will hear what Yah commands concerning you. And Yah spoke to Moshe, saying, speak to the children of Yisrael. If any man of you or your offspring shall be tameh, shall be unclean. He says, by reason of a dead or a dead body, or be on a journey far off, yet he shall asa to Yah, he shall keep the Pesach. He shall keep that. If one is from a distant, in essence, if one that was from a distant from Yerushalayim or in the wilderness from them to the outer parts of the camp, they could still come and keep the Pesach of Almighty Yah. He made this provision. We can do all things in Yahshua HaMashiach. We can keep the Moed of Almighty Yah. Shaul gives us understanding of this in a profound way in Colossians, chapter 2. These men were unclean. They had trespassed the Torah. We know what sin is. Sin is a trespassing. The word of shame, it is a trespassing of the Torah. It is a shame. It's almost like our shame, that we are ashamed of ourselves. And that's what trespassing the Torah is. Shaul gives us comfort of confirmation as to, even though our sins they have been blown up before Yah, he sees our sins, he gives us consolation here in Colossians 2nd chapter verse 13. And you, he's talking to us, they had touched the dead body, had they not? There were those that were far off, and these certain men had touched a dead body of a man. And you being dead in your sins. We've been dead in our sins. Dead in our sins. And the uncircumcision of your flesh. Your heart is not right. There's no Brit Milah. You have not gotten things right. He said, although that Yeshua HaMashiach, quickened together with him, having forgive you all of your transgressions. That's what Yah did. He said, tell them to come. I've given them, forgiven them of their transgressions. The sins will not be remembered anymore. And so we can keep the Pesach of Almighty Yah. This is a delusion of man. This is how people are seduced, and they believe it. They buy it. Oh, there's a second Pesach. It was the second year that they had come out of the land of Mizraim. They were not even organized in the ways of Yah, even in the thoughts of Yah. They didn't know Yisrael. They didn't understand the profoundness of the acts of Almighty Yah. We know that by the rebellion. It's just like we don't understand the importance of this time. It is to bring the korban, the offering of appreciation. What Yeshua has done for us, to rejoice in it, to dance, to sing, to eat, and to rejoice with Yisrael. Listen to what it says here in the next verse of Colossians 2:14. Blotting out the handwriting. See, there was an ordinance, there was a statute that these certain men had to oblige by. It says, Yeshua blotting out that ordinance. You must wash your hands in this basin. You must wash your head. Your clothes must be washed. Our garment, we have on the keli, the clothing of Sadiqah. So blotting out the handwriting of ordinance that was against us. So that handwriting of that ordinance was against those certain men. They cannot participate in the Moed of Almighty Yah. Yeshua is the power of that ordinance. So he blotted out everything that would prevent us from coming boldly on the Pesach of Yah and offering up our Korban, the offering of appreciation of testimony unto Almighty Yah. He said that ordinance, which was contrary to us, contrary, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his stake. And I'm glad of that. I'm glad of that. Even before the Pesach starts, sometimes our thoughts are just far from Almighty Yah. And so we all would have to go to the basin and wash ourselves and cleanse ourselves. And we would be unclean from that morning until the evening. So he blotted that out. He closed the door that we can come and gather in Yerushalayim, the place where his shalom is taught. He blotted it out, Yisrael. He blotted it out. That's why when Moshe and Haran sought Yah for those certain men, Yah said, bring them all in. Go out into the hedges and the highway and bring in Yisrael and tell them to bathe themselves and prepare for the Pesach. Wash their minds and wash themselves in the dam of Yeshua HaMashiach. Cleanse themselves that they may partake. So we bid the call to all Yisrael, even from this place. Again, back to be met by Numbers chapter 9. I want to take care us along in this. So it tells us in verse 11, the 14th day of the second month, at evening, they shall keep it. While the second one, he gave them time to prepare, to cleanse themselves, to be reminded of the season, that they, not all Yisrael, but those that were not cleansed according to the ordinance of the Torah of Almighty Yahweh. We are cleansed by the dam of Yeshua. We're constantly purging ourselves and cleansing ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and the ruach, and perfecting the kadosh, or the, we become kodesh in the fear of Almighty Yah. So they did not eat, they ate according to the commands of Yah. Verse 12 quickly. He commands them what to do on the Pesach, just like it was in the beginning. I want to move somewhat quickly. You all can read that. Read from Bimidbar verse 9 down to verse 13. I'm going to read here in verse 14. Hallelujah. It says, and if a stranger shall sojourn, shall be among you, and will keep. He's talking about the ger. What is a stranger? One that has no inheritance rights according to the covenant of Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov. They have no covenant right. They're strangers to the commonwealth of Yisrael. But if one be among you and has dwelt with you, you deal with that stranger just like an ach, a brother, or an ahot. And if a stranger dwells among you and will keep the Pesach according to the ordinance of the Pesach and according to the manner thereof, so shall he do. So shall he participate and keep the Pesach of Yah. You shall have one hukkah, one statute, one ordinance, both for the stranger and for them that are born in the land. There is one Torah. There is one Abba, one HaMashiach, and we are immersed in him unto the Abba. And there is one Emuna. It's not two or three. There is no second Pesach. It is to demonstrate the advent of the coming of Yeshua and to give us knowledge of this great cleansing power that shall come in this living Torah. So if a man sins, he doesn't have to wait until evening to be cleansed or that he's able to touch or embrace. He is cleansed by the dam of Yeshua HaMashiach. There is no need of the sprinkling of the red heifer. There is no need for the offering of the sun or the Pesach lamb. For he has been offered in the context of the living word in Yeshua HaMashiach. So we don't have to do that, Yisrael. None whatsoever. Hallelujah. I want to read something quickly here. May the blessings of Yah rest upon his people. Here in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 19. Let me read this quickly. I looked at this before I left the house. I want to read this. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 19. It's either the truth or it is not the truth. This is what Shaul speaks here. It says, to wit, to understand that Almighty Yahweh was in Yeshua HaMashiach. He is the living word. He is the breath of that body of clay. What he did, reconcile, brought back, reconciling the world unto himself. And I'm glad for this next statement. Not charging, not in putting their trespasses unto them, but have committed unto us the words of reconciliation. And that is what that event was with Moshe, the reconciling of the whole house of Yisrael. Even in your sins, you're reconciled. Even in the vilest of our ways, the dam of Yeshua cleanses and washes us from all of our sin. And we can keep, we can asah, we can keep the moed of Yah. It is not in some form of ritualism or some form of tradition. There is only one way to keep it, by Emunah. And that is to remember the event of the great hand of Almighty Yahweh. That's what it's about. And to understand the great event of the death of Yeshua HaMashiach. No, we don't rejoice in that, but we rejoice in the power of the testimony. I won't let the world take that away from me. We rejoice in that testimony, so we celebrate it. We celebrate it with great fervor and with great strength. Quickly, here in the book of Devarim, he tells us in the book of Devarim, chapter 16, verse 1 and 2. I've read that, but you remind yourself of this. Let me read one verse in verse 2. You shall therefore zebach, or make the offering, the slaughter, the killing. You shall sacrifice the Pesach unto Yahweh Abba, of the flock of the herd, in the place which Yah has chosen to place his name. Now there's a doctor that says we cannot keep the Mo'adim of Yah. And yet Yahushua, they kept the Pesach of Yah even in Gilgal, outside of the city of Yerushalayim. And they kept it until the time that Shlomo built the house of Omaniyah. And there are those say you cannot. There are those that say that there's a second Pesach. There's only one coming of Yahushua. When he comes, there is no second coming. He shall come the second time. And those that are filthy, they shall be filthy still when he comes the second time. He came the first time to establish the law of his reconciliation, that he has reconstituted Israel back unto him. That's why we bring our korban, our offering of appreciation unto Yah on Pesach. That's why. Hallelujah. And that's why we do that. And so we continue on down to Devarim 16. Hallelujah. It tells us when, how to process this, the time of the season. And so you read Devarim 16 down to Devarim verse 6. It tells us that we celebrate the Pesach at evening at the going down of the sun in verse 6. Hallelujah. Because that was the season Yah brought them out of Mitzrayim. I don't want to go into those details. I want to deal with the second or the Shani Pesach. All right? And see if this is an ordination of Yah. It was only at that time that Yah allowed that. It was only for that. And Yahushua has, he has reconciled us unto the Abba Yisrael. So we can keep the Pesach of Almighty Yah in Yahushua HaMashiach. There's another event here in 1 Malachim, 1 Kings. In chapter 12, hallelujah. Because Jeroboam had introduced such idolatry among Israel, they hated, they despised the gathering of the Mo'adim of Almighty Yah. And so what he did, he began to set up his own feast days to draw the people away from going in to Yerushalayim. I want to move expeditiously here because I want to cover this all tonight. It says in 1 Kings chapter 12, verse 25. 1 Kings 12:25. It says, then Jeroboam, he built the city of Shechem in Mount Ephraim and dwelt therein. And he went out from there and he rebuilt Penuel. Jeroboam said, you must understand where this came from. He said in his heart in verse 26. Now shall the kingdom return unto the house of David, or Beit David. If this people go up to do zabach or offerings in Beits of Yah at Yerushalayim, then shall the hearts of the people, the Levim, or the heart of the people of this people return again to the Most High, to the Master, even to Rehoboam, king of Yehuda, and they shall kill me and go again to Rehoboam, king of Yehuda. Now, this is how he began to compromise, and with the subtleties of darkness, he says, whereupon the Melech, he took counsel, and he made two calves of gold. We're reminded of the golden calves when they came out of Mitzrayim. He made two. And he said to them, it is too much for you to go to Yerushalayim. Behold your gods, O Yisrael, which brought you out of the land of Mitzrayim. And he set the one in Beth-El, and the other put he in Dan. And this thing became a sin. It became wickedness. It became a hata. For the people went and worshiped before one, even in Dan. Hear this, Yisrael. And he made a house of high places, and he made Kohen. He made those that to carry out the responsibilities of Yah and his Bayat. He made Kohen. He made them of the lowest of the people. So their degree of the people of Yah. He made them of the lowest. He did not appoint those that were of the tribe of Levi. He made Kohen of the lowest of the people, which were not sons of Levi. He did not, as Yah ordained, that all the Kohen must be a son of Levi. They must come out of the Shebat, the tribe of Levi. So he skirted the very ordinance of Yah, and he made those that were not of the same equality in the knowledge of Torah to dispense the knowledge of Torah. He made those that would consult with his gods. You understand, Yisrael? Now look what happened in the next verse, verse 32. And Yeroboam ordained a feast in the eighth month. Well, we know what feast takes place in the seventh month. It is the Sukkot. On the 15th day of the month, isn't that when Sukkot takes place? On the 15th day of the month, like the feast that is in Yehuda, and he offered upon the altar. So did he in Bethel. He offered calves. He sacrificed to the calves that he had made, and he placed in Bethel Kohen in the high places which he had made. So instead of them, now is that a replication of a second Sukkot? I want to draw it all together. Here, this man was the king of Ephraim, and his brother was the Melech of Yehuda, Yehuda and Benjamin, those tribes, the split house or the separated house. And so he ordains a feast day. Now there are those that say, Yah hates our feast days. Sure, he hates our feast days. This is what he hates. He doesn't hate his feast days, because Pesach is Yah's feast days. Masvah is the feast day of Yah. He hates this. He hates this false delusional mindset that say you could have a second Pesach. He hates that. He hated this because it is sin. It gives provision for sin that you will not be complicit in all obedience as to what Yah commands you. You understand? That is what he hates. He hates our feast days. He hated the feast days of the golden calves. He hates the feast days that we ordain, but he gives us precise instruction. Yeah. Instead of the seventh month, he said, I'll hold it in the eighth month. Instead of them eating in the first month of the Pesach of Yah, Yah commanded the second month. You give them 30 days. You give them time of the new moon that they can prepare themselves. And not only them, but the Kohen as well. But that does not mean he altered the time. There's a Torah to all things, as there's a Torah to the sun, the moon, a Torah to our lives. So it is a Torah of the Mo'adim that are governed by the lunar actions of the heavens. You understand, Yisrael? So he said, I will have a feast day. I will keep Sukkot. Does that mean that there's a second Sukkot? I will show you where they kept a Sukkot in the eighth month, and Yah ordained it. Does that mean that it's the second Sukkot? I'm drawing the parallels between Pesach and Sukkot. Can I move quickly? Hallelujah. It says, so he offered in verse 33, so he offered up upon the altar which he had made in Bethel on the 15th day of the eighth month, even in the month which he had devised. You see that, Yisrael? It meant that they are devising what days and what time to keep the Pesach by their own ignorance and stupidity. They think they understand Hanukkah, but I will bring that into great wisdom and delight, understanding on the Shabbat, which he had devised of his own left. and ordain a feast to the children of Israel, and he offered upon the altars and the burnt incense. That's why Yah says in Amos, he says, I hate your feast days, your gathering. This is what he hates. This is what Yah despises. He devised in his own heart. He said, there is no sweet smell in your assembly when you come together on your feast days. Yah says, I hate them. Not only does he sane, but he says, I despise them. I my eyes, all of your wicked feast days. Now, here is an event in the book of 2 Chronicles, 2 Debari HaYaim. Here in 2 Chronicles chapter 30, verse 1. Now, you must understand this scenario, all right? When Hezekiah, he invites all Israel to come to Jerusalem to celebrate the Pesach and to keep the feast of Almighty Yah. Now look what happens here. 2 Chronicles 31. And Hezekiah sent to all Israel and Yehuda, the whole house. And he wrote a letter, to Ephraim, Manasseh, that they should come to the bed of Yah at Yerushalayim, to Asa, to keep the Pesach of Yah, the sovereign master of Yisrael. He said, I want you to come. He was the Melech, he was the king. 2 Chronicles 30, verse 1. He said, I want you to come to the Pesach. Why did he invite them? The Pesach is always representative of a repentance, that we examine our hearts, that he was saying, repent, Yehuda, repent, Ephraim. Don't we search our hearts for the leaven and to make sure we rid our homes of the leaven, anything that is offensive to Yah? Verse 2, for the king had taken counsel of his princes and all the congregations of Yerushalayim to keep the Pesach in the second month. There was a reason why. Hallelujah. It says, for they could not keep it at that time. Why could they not keep it in its proper time? Because those that were the administrators of it, they were filthy. It says, because the Kohanim had not set themselves apart. They had not made themselves kadosh sufficiently, neither had the people gathered together in Yerushalayim. Those that were the administrators of it. And Yah honored that, Yisrael, no second Pesach. But Yahshua coming, he has made us clean and washed us from all of our sins. He has purified us, Yisrael. And so Yah permitted that because it was a time or drawing of a time to call Yisrael, the house, the whole house, to repentance. And yet even those that administered the Torah of Yah, they were not even right. They were not even ready to offer up. They were unclean. They were not right. We are without any excuse, Yisrael. We have no excuse not to be clean and our hands washed from all the filthiness of our own flesh. It says because the Kohanim had not made themselves right and the people were not gathered. Verse 4. And this thing pleased the king and all the congregation of Yisrael. It goes on to say, so they established a decree to make a proclamation throughout all Yisrael, from Beersheba even unto Dan. For what reason? That they should come and keep the Pesach of Yah, the sovereign master of Yisrael and Yerushalayim. Listen to the next line. You see what it says here? For they had not. For they had not. Because the Kohens were filthy. The Kohen were filthy. They were not reading the Torah. Prepare the minds of the people, for they had not done it of a long time in such sort as it was written. They had not kept it, my ark. Just like we in the Baptist and the Methodist and the Pentecost, we didn't keep it. Because we did not know the writing of the sort. And the writing of the sort was not read by the Kohen, the Kohen, the priests. I mean, those are the Levi of the tribe. And so they had not kept it. And so there's a difference in every application where we can see where Yah suffered it. The Kohen were not clean enough to carry out the responsibility of Yah. They were filth and vile. They had not read the ordinance of Yah's ordination of Pesach. And they had not done it for a long time. They had not done it for a long time. So they were not accustomed to the rituals and the washing and the cleansing of themselves. As they would say, Toda Yahweh Yahshua HaMashiach. He put it all in his hands, all right? Here's the cleansing atonement of Israel. They had not done it for a long time. They had not. And so when Hezekiah found it, oh my, he was excited. So he sent out a letter to the whole house of Israel. Come to Yerushalayim. We're going to keep the Pesach of Yah. Remind our babies of the great hand of Yah as he brought us out of the land of Mizraim. So he was excited. He was so excited. Let's keep the Pesach of Yah. Hear me quickly. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It says they had not done it for a long time. They had not kept the Pesach. They had not been a part of that. They had not kept it for a long time. Hold that. Will you listen to this, what Yahweh says in 2 Corinthians 7:1? This is for us right here. We're going back to 2 Chronicles now. But look what it says in 2 Corinthians 7:1. Having therefore these promises of what the Torah, what is written, what was said. 2 Corinthians 7:1. Having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us. See now, let you cleanse yourself from all filthiness of the flesh and the ruach, perfecting pure set of partners in the fear of Yah. Now let us cleanse ourselves. Now we understand, we can see what Hezekiah did. We can see what the certain men did. Now let us cleanse ourselves and set ourselves apart for the Moed of Almighty Yah. In the fear of Yah. Let us reverence Yah. Let us have the Yareh of Yah, the Yirah, the fear Yah, with great fear Yisrael. They had not kept the feast in a long time. Just like that certain man, it was the second year. We know from Yahshua's time has been nearly 2,000 years, and we have not kept it right either. I can show you a place in the book where they didn't keep the feast day for 900 years. You hear the truth, you repent, and you keep it. It's in the book. I'll read that quickly, all right? Let me move on here in 2 Chronicles. I don't intend to teach every aspect of this. This would take 10, 12 teachings to teach this, for me to do it in the manner that I wanted to. I want to get this in us, all right? It says in 2 Chronicles 36, so the post went with the letter from the king and his princes throughout all Yisrael and Yehuda, according to the command of the king, saying, you children of Yisrael, he tells them the shub, turn again to Yah, the sovereign master of Abraham, Yitzchok, and Yaakov, Yisrael. And it says that he will return to the remnant of you, just a remnant, the boy here. If we turn, he will return unto us, Yisrael, that our escape out of the hands of the kings of Assyria. You've been in captivity. We have been in this land. We escape out of the hands of the bondage of the darkness of this land. He will return unto us. If we return unto, if we make a change, we should turn ourselves around from the tentativeness of this nation and the ways of this world. That's all we have to do. Verse 7, and be not like your avat and like your ach, which trespass the ma'al, they sin. There was an act of unfaithfulness which trespassed against Yah, the sovereign master of the Avats, who therefore gave them up to desolation. As you see, Yah is the one that gives us up to desolation. He's the one that gives us unto destruction. For what? Because he is able to save us. He's able to redeem us. He's able to bear us up, Yisrael. He's going to prove his hand to his house. That's why the more dems are of such beauty to us. And we should celebrate them that way. And I want to show us how we should celebrate them, all right? He said, now don't be stiff-necked as your fathers, verse 8, but yield yourself to Yah and enter into his Mikdash place, which he has set apart, Olam Viat, and serve Yah, you about that, that the fierceness of his wrath may be turned away from you. He told us to enter into the Bayat. He says, fear Yah, enter into his Bayat. Is there any constitution in the Torah for us? We can't go to Yerushalayim. There is no house there. It's torn down. They have what they call the wailing of the wall of that house, the former house. But Shaul gives us such great strength of motivation here in 1 Corinthians. I'm going back to Chronicles now. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9. He says, my people, what? Yada, don't you know 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19? He says, what? He says, my people, what? Know you not that your body is the Beit HaMikdash? That's what he says there. That's what he says. Don't you know your body is the Beit HaMikdash of the Ruach HaKodesh, which is in you, which you have of Yah, and you are not your own? Don't you know there is where the profoundness of the Moed of Yah has its indelible workings in us in this house here, Yisrael. Don't you know that Moshe kept the Pesach by Emunah? We must have faith in this house to keep it. We must have that. We can come to this building. That doesn't mean we are asah. We're fashioning our mind to retain this testimony of great power. So as he says in 1 Corinthians, as Hezekiah says here at first, in Chronicles where we left off. He says in 2 Chronicles 30 verse 8, he said, don't be stiff-necked. He said, enter into the Mikdash place which he has set apart. Don't you know your body has been set apart? We're no more our own, but we belong to Yah. The references is equated right here. It is the same thing. Our body is the place. It is the house, the Bayat of Almighty Yah. And this is where we fashion our minds and our hearts to keep the Pesach and the Moedim of Almighty Yah. Hallelujah. Now look at verse 9. Even when Yahshua talked about destroying the house, the Bayat, he said, in 3 days, I will raise it up again. And they were too ignorant. He did not speak of the building, but he spoke of his body. Doesn't it say that in the book of Yahachan? That he did not speak of that building that he saw, but he spoke of his body. And this is what the same thing that Hezekiah is speaking of here. We see the fullness of that power in Yahshua. We see the revelation of that in Yahshua HaMashiach Yisrael. That's what he says. Verse 9 of 2 Chronicles 30. For if you turn again to Yah, your Abba, turn again to Yah, your Abba, your Ak, your brother, your children shall find compassion before them that lead them captive. So they shall come again into this land. For Yah, your Abba, he is kind, he is full of chesed, and he has compassion and will not turn away his face from you. If we just turn to him, this is our sure act of our faithfulness unto Yah. That's why Hezekiah, when he found out we had missed the mark, he said, I tell you what, send out the letter. It's going to be done urgently. That's why I made the analogy that when one comes to town to celebrate one's birthday, and one's birthday is today, and they don't get here till the weekend, they still celebrate the birthday, don't they? They celebrate it with vigor, excitement. Don't they celebrate the birthday? That doesn't mean that the birthday is on Sunday, but it means the birthday was today. But they cannot get the town to then. And so when he found out this great truth of the knowledge, the Kohen began to read of the great blessing of Yah because they were faithful unto that. He said, set everything in motion. Set everything in motion. Yah knew the heart of Hezekiah. That's where he added days to the man's life when he turned his face to the wall and he cried out unto Yah. When the Nobi said, get your house in order because Yah's going to bring it down to hell. And he turned his face unto Almighty Yah. And y'all, he had a testimony, didn't he? He had this was his testimony because he obeyed truth, Yisrael. And Yahshua is our testimony. Moving quickly here. Hallelujah. Verse 10. So the apostles went and passed from city to city throughout the country of Ephraim and Manasseh and even to Zebulun. But look what happened. But they laughed. They sahak. They laughed them to scorn and they mocked them. They said, we're not going to buy that. We're not going to be a part of that. We don't have to keep the Moedim of Yah. And there have been many that were among us, as Kepha said, they were among us, but they were never of us. They have no thought, no love for the Moedim of Yah. They mock it. That was one of the first things they did. They began to discount it. And so when the messenger of Yah, when he says, go tell my people, they began to mock and laugh. Oh, you don't have to keep that. You don't have to do that. You don't have to keep the Moedim of Yah. And so they mock. You see that? It says they mock, they laughed at the messenger sent by Hezekiah. Hallelujah. Nevertheless, some, only a few of Asher and Manasseh and Zebulun, it says that they humble themselves. And they came to Yerushalayim. They humbled themselves. Also in Yehuda, and the hand of Yah was given to them. See, when they did that, when they obeyed, although it was out of ignorance, they didn't keep the Moedim. But because they were faithful in the act, they wanted to get it right with Yah. Look what he did to them in verse 12. It says, also in Yehuda, the hand of Yah was given to them, what? One left, one heart, to do the commandment of the king. Because the king's heart was right to do that. To do the commandment of the Melech and the princes by the word of Yah. He was reestablishing the power of that great victory of testimony. He granted unto them when he brought them out of the land of Mizraim, Yisrael. And that is what the Moedim of Yah do. That's what they are for. Remind us of the great power that we celebrate our Abba. And they assembled in Yerushalayim many rabba, many people, to Asa the Chag of Matzvah in the second month, a great congregation, a gadol gathering of the people of one mind. What did they do? And they arose and took away the altars that were in Yerushalayim, and all the altars for the incense. They took them away and cast them in the brook of Kidron. And it says, and then they killed the Pesach on the 14th day of the second month. And the Kohen and the Levi were ashamed. You see who were ashamed? It says the Kohen. Does it say that? And those that were the Levi, they were ashamed because they knew. We ought to be ashamed when we have negated the commands of Yah. We don't set our attention to understand the time and the season. Although we erred, if we erred last year, let's get it right. And although we error, we made error, let's get it right this year. And we make error this year, let's get it right next year. And the Kohen and the Levi, they were ashamed. They were ashamed. They were kalah. They were dishonored, Yisrael. They were humiliated. Why were they ashamed? And set themselves apart. They were so ashamed of their activities, not diligently paying attention to the Torah, that they had not kept the Pesach for a long time. They had not kept the Pesach of Yah for a long time. And so when the knowledge of that was revealed, they were excited. It's like we should be excited. We should rejoice that Yah has granted us to Asa to keep the Pesach, to understand the power of that testimony. Look what it says here in verse 16. And they stood in their places after their manner. How did they stand? They take their position according to the Torah of Moshe, the man of Almighty Yahweh. They took their rightful place, my Zaki. They stood according to the template of the Tasnith, the order of Torah. And the order of Torah is right. We need no sacrifice. We have the perfect Zabak Yeshua HaMashiach. So we are saw. We keep the Pesach of Omariah, the Mo'adem Ma'imona. They kept it according to the Torah Moshe, the man of Yah. The Kohen sprinkling of the blood. I'm glad for the sprinkling of the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach. The wash, I said, the sprinkling of the blood, which they receive of the hands of the Levim, of the Levi. Verse 17. For there were many of the congregation that were not clean. There were many that were not clean. There were many that were not clean. Therefore, the Levi had the charge of killing the Pesach for everyone that was not clean, to set them apart unto Yah. Pesach evening, we won't be clean. But Yah has sent Yeshua HaMashiach, the living Lamb, to set us apart unto Him. We will enter into His court, His presence, with thoughts that are defiling, unclean, and wicked. And yet, Yeshua is the cleansing atonement. I will prove it out to us, all right? There were many that were unclean because they didn't know. Strangers don't know, but if they come to be a part of the Pesach, they don't know Yisrael. There were many that were unclean. And yet the Levi had to offer the offering unto Yah. I'm glad Yeshua offered the offering for our sins. I'm glad of that, Yisrael, not me. Not me. But I'm glad He has made the perfect offering for our sins. Hallelujah. 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 For a multitude, verse 18, for a multitude of the people, even many of Ephraim, and Manasseh, and Issachar, and Zebulun, had not cleansed themselves. Yet, did eat the Pesach otherwise than it was written. They were not even cleansed. And yet they ate the Pesach. And you know that if you're not clean and eating the Pesach, your hands are not clean, then woe unto you. But look at the true heart of a king, that Yah is our king. It says, but, Hezekiah Pala Metefireth prayed for them, saying, he says, Yah, I know your tav. All the time, he prayed for them. He prayed. He cried to Yah. He said, I know your tav. And he will pardon every one of them. And he pardoned every one of them. He pardoned them. Although they were unclean, Yisrael. That's why the prayer of teshuva, of repentance, must be made. Shaul warns us in 1 Corinthians 11. And I want to go back to Chronicles, all right? 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 27. We'll read this often. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat the bread and drink this cup of Yeshua unworthily shall be guilty of his body and blood of Yeshua. That's what they were guilty of when Hezekiah prayed. They were guilty. They were guilty of their sins. There were no cleansing of their sins. Verse 28, he said, first of all, this is what we must do. This is the catalyst here. But let a man examine himself. Let us just examine ourselves. Let a man examine himself. And so let him eat that bread and drink of that cup. Examine yourself and pray the prayer of Hezekiah. Yah, you're tov. You're tov all the time. I know I'm unworthy. You examine yourself, Yisrael. For he that eateth, drinketh unworthy, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the body of Yeshua HaMashiach. He said, for this cause many are weak. Because we have not discerned the testimony of his body. He tells us to remember to Zachar, to Asa, this Pesach. to remember the value of the body of Yeshua HaMashiach. And don't do it as they mocked the messengers of Hezekiah. Don't say, oh, this, we got to do that. We got to wash someone's foot. You don't do that, Yisrael. They mocked those individuals that went and commanded them according to Torah. See, when we examine ourselves and we know our own hearts, it is revealed unto us. Just like Hezekiah prayed, yeah, I know they're unclean. We all are. We haven't kept this thing for a long, long time. When I heard the words of the Kohen, when I heard the blare of the shofar, and we were reminded of Moshe and this great event, forgive us. Just let us celebrate it. Not a second Pesach. We're cleansed by the dam of Yeshua HaMashiach. That's what washes and cleanses us from all of our sins. There were not enough Kohen to wash and to cleanse all the people. There were not enough Yisrael. That's why they were ashamed of themselves. They had the sense of dishonor. Is that not written in your book? Many times we don't know things because we don't take time to search things, Yisrael. Our heart's not excited about the Torah of Yah. And that's just the truth. Hallelujah. And so many are weakly, many are sickly among you, and many are dead. Many are dead because we have not examined ourselves. We have not understood that we are all unworthy. That's what Hezekiah said. They are unworthy. We are unworthy because, first of all, we have removed this proper event from its proper place. But yeah, our hearts are excited. We're so glad that we're reminded of it. We haven't kept it for a long, long time. Years have passed, and it had been almost eradicated from the minds of the Kohen because they were so lustful in attaining their own flesh. And now I heard the voice of the Kohen. I heard the Torah read, and I say, my. And I set my heart to establish this testimony. When he turned his face to the wall, he had a memorial. He had a zikron before Yah. And Yah says, go back and tell the man he's going to live. Hallelujah. And we're going to live. We're going to live, Yisrael, because of Yahshua. Because he lived, we live. All right? Back again, 2 Chronicles 30:19. It says that prepared his left to seek Yah and the Abba of his father, though he be not cleansed according. You understand that? Though those people, though I am not, 2 Chronicles 30:19, though they be not cleansed according to the purification of the Kador's place. He said, I know we're not clean. We're cleansed by the dam. I'm so glad. He said, according to the purification, they're not clean. We are not clean. And it says, and Almighty Yahweh listened. He shemach. He heard, he hearkened to Hezekiah. And then he healed the people. He made them whole, Yisrael. He healed the people. He healed them. He made their heart one. They were ignorant of the matter. We are still ignorant. We are ignorant. And he healed the people because of that prayer of that king Hezekiah. Listen what it says in verse 21. And the children of Yisrael that were present at Yerushalayim kept Hach Matzvah 7 days. Look how they kept it with great gladness, with shimcha. They were glad. And the Levites and the Kohen, they praise Yah day by day. What else did they do? Singing. Kara, singing. Shiram, singing. Kara, with what? With loud instruments to Yah. So it's not a time that you become somewhat docile. You sing with loud instruments. And every year we revive, we become more in tune with what Torah says. There is no tradition to the Moed or the Pesach of Almighty Yah. This is how they celebrate it. And Hezekiah spoke comfortably to all the Levi that taught the top knowledge of Yah. And look what they did. And they did eat. I love to eat the beautiful dainties of Yah, not only the Torah above all, but the blessings as he blessed the land to have wonderful food, and they did eat. Undoubtedly, that's a part of it. It said, and they did eat. If it was not significant, he would not have mentioned it. If it was not significant, he would not have mentioned it. They sing, they play loud instruments, and they, and in the words of Hezekiah, comforted the people, and they did eat throughout the feast days, 7 days. Doing what? Offering the offering of shalom. That's why we come and offer the offering of shalom and Torah. Doing what? Making yada, confess your sins one to another. And then the effectual fervent prayer of the Sadiq availeth much. Confessing yada to Yah the Abba of the Avat. And the whole assembly took counsel to keep not only those 7 days. They say we have in such a great time other 7 days. So then if they had a second Pesach, then that's a third Pesach. The ignorance of the minds of this generation. They kept it for 7 more days. And they kept other 7 days. How? With gladness. That's why Yisrael, we must confess, as Yaakov said, we must confess our faults one unto another. We must do that as a nation of people. And then as Hezekiah did, and pray one for another, Yisrael. For what? That you, let's turn that. Turn to Yaakov. James chapter 5. It says, and Yah healed them in Chronicles. Did it not say that? Where did that verse? Where it says, and Yah healed them. It says, and Yah in 2 Chronicles 30:20. Hold that. And then I want you to turn to Yaakov 5:16. It is the same, Yisrael. Nothing is different. James chapter 5, verse 16. I want to read it like it says it. Hallelujah. He tells us, confessing your faults one to another, pray one for another that you might be what? Healed. It says in 2 Chronicles 30:20, and Yah listened to Hezekiah, and he healed Rapha, and he healed the people. And he healed the people. Yeah. Confessing our faults one to another. Pray for one another that we may be healed. Therefore, the effectual fervent prayer of the Sadiq man availeth much. Was not Hezekiah a Sadiq man? Yeah. Did it not his prayer avail much? Did it not bring the healing among Yisrael? Our confessions is what bring the healing. And we come to this time, we just confess it, Yisrael. Yeah. Don't be arrogant, haughty, and full of pride. We confess it. Hallelujah. I'm going to finish this. I'm going to finish this. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Confessing our faults one unto another. Verse 24 of the same chapter of 2 Chronicles. I want to go back there. So they kept the Pesach Matzvah for 14 days. My Zakin Yaramiya. So undoubtedly, if there's a second one, it's got to be a third one. It's got to be. For Hezekiah, king of Yehuda, did give to the congregation 1,000 bullocks. And it tells us in that verse what all he offered unto Yah. Verse 25, and all the congregation of Yehuda and the Kohim and the Levi'im, and all the congregation that came out of Yerushalayim, were there strangers? And it says, and the stranger and the ger. Those that are temporary inhabitants of Yisrael, Jerusalem, in the gear that came to the land of Yisrael that dwell in Yehuda, it says they rejoice. Listen to this in the next verse. So there was a great joy in Jerusalem, for since the time of Shlomo, the son of David, king of Yisrael, there was nothing like in Jerusalem. So when they heard of that, undoubtedly, they were excited. And they invested all they had. That is how it should be. You divest yourself of you, and you invest in the power of the testimony of Yahshua HaMashiach. They rejoice. It was singing and dancing and eating. They made preparation. That's why he says too early. We can't do this overnight. We're going to do it in the second month according to the Moedim, according to that sign. We will keep. They kept the Tasnith, the pattern. And from the time of Shlomo, there was never time of the offerings unto Yah like that. And so from the time our Pesach, we that gather, those that gather in Yisrael, it should not be like the one last year, the year before that one. There should be not a time like this Pesach among us like it has ever been, Yisrael. Because we're reminded of things. Our minds are renewed of the greatness of Yah's power. There was never a time like that. And the king prayed, and Yah healed them. We confess our faults and pray that Yah heal us, Yisrael. You see, there's no dichotomy in that word. It is one true word. It is a Torah. And Yahshua is the Torah of that life. He is the Torah. He is the word, Yisrael. He is the word. Hallelujah. And also it says, and then after all of that, verse 27, then the Kohanim and the Leviim arose and they berach, they blessed the people. And listen, and their voice was heard and their prayer. Now these men were ashamed, they were unclean. And their prayer came up to his Kodesh dwelling place, even to the Shema'am. I want my prayers to go there. I don't want my prayers as many times they feel like they're here. Just a head thing. I want my prayers to enter. I want my palat to enter there, Yisrael. And he heard them. And so they said, 7 days, just not enough. We have not kept this in so many years. Oh, no, no. And so they hold cook and they dance. Their bodies were not exhausted. I want to see that kind of celebration among young people. That we come, we hear the reading of the Torah and the music and the dance and the singing and we eat and we dine and we bless the name of Yah and Yahshua HaMashiach. That's the way it should be. It should be no time of Purim. It should be a time of great celebration. We should become invigorated and vibrant with this power of the testimony for every Moedim, especially Pesach, Matzvah, and Sukkoth, as we gather in the fruits of the season. That's the way it should be. So it could not be a third Pesach, can it? There's only one Pesach. There's only one offering. And Yahshua is that offering. In our ignorance of our delusion, they had come out. Second year, they didn't know. And because of their sins, they began to dilute the ways of Yah. And they had not kept it for a long time. And when the king said, oh my, you don't know what we're missing. Just like we didn't keep it for a long time. And so we don't realize what we have missed out on. We don't realize what we have missed. So we should redeem the time every year. Oh, it's going to be exciting this year. Hallelujah. No, it won't be like last year, but it's going to be greater than last year. How about that? Can I show an account here in the book of Nehemiah? Hallelujah. I want to dismantle that lie of the second Pesach. No more than Rehoboam with the second Sukkot. But I want to read this account here in the book of Nehemiah. It's important that I read it. Nehemiah chapter 8. This event took place when the Kohen began to read the Torah of Yah. That's why the feast days are. I don't know if we have all the books of the Torah or the first five. But I want to this year that we can play it on our speaker. We can turn it down. That loud, those speakers we have out there, you can hear them all the way in the Jefferson. You understand? But I want us to play the reading of the Torah, and all day we will hear it. If someone got a problem with it, let them come and tell us, all right? But you can hear that thing. You can turn it up, just tweak it a little bit. You can hear that thing all the way into Jefferson. But I want us to do that. You can't hear when you're right up on it. But when you get a distance from those speakers, and those speakers cost quite a bit of money, that's why we bought them. Because I wanted them ones down there to be able to hear where I wanted them to hear. And those things will reach. I remember the first day I was on the other side, I said, Simeon, that? It was just as clear as I'm talking here. It's clear from a distance. than it is when you're close up. You can't even hardly hear the thing in my house. But when you get a distance, and it should be that way. My Ach Yosipia said, I want to read the Torah one day. I want to just sit down. I said, do it, son. Take your time. You don't understand the meaning of the word. I mean, you don't enunciate the word properly. That's all right. Even in all that southern drawl, that's all right. I said to him, do it, Ach. Go ahead and do it. Let Simeon such up, come over here and take an hour and read. And do the whole Torah of Yah. Do the first five books. Spend a little time to enunciate the words. You'll get them right. They're not that difficult to enunciate. I will read this account. The reading of the Torah was read. And the know and the strive, the writer, the prophet, Nehemiah. You must understand, Yisra'iyah, in this account, listen to me. They had not celebrated Sukkot for over 900 years. They had not kept the Moed of Yah for 900 years. Now look what happened here. So is there a second Sukkot? No, it isn't. There's only one. Sin, when we allow sin in, we will corrupt ourselves. We will forget the ways of Yah. It doesn't take long. When people, whereby they're not in constant contact of refining, reproving themselves among those that live with them, among the words that they hear, they will go off in some of the deepest of ends and do some of the most wickedest of things. You can justify them all you want to, but they're still wicked. They do some of the most vilest, and they're susceptible to any kind of lie. They'll believe anything. Listen to this event here, Nehemiah chapter 8, verse 1. I want to move quickly because I want to finish. It says here in Nehemiah chapter 8, verse 1. And all the Am, the nation, the people of Yah, gathered themselves together as one man in the street that was before the water gate. And they spoke to Ezra the scribe to bring the Sefer, the book of the Torah, Moshe, which Yah had commanded Israel. And Ezra, the Kohen, he brought the Torah, the book, before the congregation, both men and women, that they could shemach and be no understand upon the first day. Now listen, of the seventh month, the time of the Sukkah, the first day of the seventh month. And he read therein before the street that was before the water gate, and the morning until midday he read. Oh my, that's, you think most people couldn't handle that? So he read all day out of the Torah before the men and the women and those that could understand. And the ears of all the people were attentive to the Sefer of the Torah. They gave themselves to hear what this scribe, this messenger of Yah, was reading. And Ezra the scribe stood upon a pulpit of wood, which they had made for the purpose. And beside him stood Matithiah, and Shema, and Ananah, and Uriah, and Hilkiah, and Manasseh on his right hand. And on the left hand stood Pediah, and Mishael, and Melchiah, and Hashum, and Hashbanah, and Zechariah, and Meshulam. Then the scribe Ezra, in verse 5, he opened the book in the sight of all the people. See, there is no hanky-panky here. For he was above the people when he sadach. And all the people stood up. And Ezra Brachia, the great sovereign master, and all the people answered, Amen, so be it. Let it be fulfilled. Were lifting up their hands, and they bowed their head, and they sahah, they worship Yah with their face to the ground. Also Yeshua and Benah and Shirabiah and Yamim and Achub En Shabbat Bethcha en Chadzia en Masahya en Kilita en Azaraya en Yechzabad en Hanna en Pilia en de Levi. Cause the people, these messengers as they read, to understand the Torah. And the people stood in their place. Verse 8, hear this. So they read in the book of the Torah of Yah distinctly, and gave the sense and caused them to understand the reading. And Nehemiah, which is the Krishata, and Ezra the Kohen, the scribe, and the Levi'im, that taught the people, said to all the people, this day is Kadosh to Yahweh Abba. Mourn not, do not weep, for all the people wept when they heard the words of the Torah. They hadn't heard it like that for 900 years. They was excited. They had not heard, so they cried. They hadn't kept the Sukkah of Yah. Then he said to them, go your way, eat the fat, and drink the sweet, and send portions to them who have nothing is prepared. For this is kadosh to our sovereign. Neither be sorry for joy, for the joy of Yah is your strength. So those that were the Levi'im stood still, all the people saying, ho your shalom. For this day is set apart to Yah. Don't be grievous. Don't be sad. And all the people went their way to eat and to drink and to send portions and to make great mirth because they had understood the words that were declared unto them. Only when our minds are restored unto Yah, we have the mind of Yeshua, are we going to understand the teaching of the Torah. We will never until we let that same mind that was in Yeshua HaMashiach be in us. And it is one sure sign of that. When they understood, what did they do? They broke out with joy, didn't they? When we understand Torah, there's going to be a great joy and a great revival. That's why we, in the religious order, they have revivals. And when we hear the reading of the Torah, it revives us. It causes us to come alive. Hear this, Yisrael, in verse 13. And on the second day, were gathered together the chiefs of the fathers and all the people in the Kohim and the Levi of the Levi'im and to Ezra the scribe, even to understand the words of the Torah. And look what they did in verse 14. And they found. We seek with all of our heart, set our affection on him, we will find. And they found written in the Torah, which Yah had commanded by Moshe that the children of Yisrael should dwell in booths in the feast in the seventh month. They found that place. All that Yisrael, they shall dwell in booths. You eat in the booth, you sleep in the booth. Oh, I know it doesn't make us right, but Yah commanded us to do that. We get immersed, don't we? All that were Yisrael, they dwelt in booths. Listen to what it says. And they that saw published the proclamation in all their cities and in Yerushalayim, said, go forth to the mountains and fetch olive branches and pine branches and myrtle branches and palm branches and branches of the thick trees and make booths as it is written. And the people went forth and they brought them and they made themselves booths, every man upon the roof of his house and in the courts and in the courts of their homes. And in the streets of the water gates and the streets of the gates of Ephraim. And all the congregation of them that will come again out of captivity made booths and sat under the booths. For since the day of Yeshua, the son of Nun, to the day had not the children of Israel done so. So they were very glad. So if you search the chronicles of the Torah, it was 900 years. They had not kept the feast day. Their children didn't even know until it was read in the place, until the scribe Ezra read it. Only then that they understand. They had not kept it for 900 years. So I say to us, Yisraya, it's not to our disadvantage, although we don't know, we did not know to keep the Moedim of Yah. We just fashion ourselves according to the testimony of Yah. It is not some kind of ritualistic form of how we do things. No. They had not kept it for 900 years. But yet, when they come to the knowledge of that truth, the proclamation was made, make booths. Everybody could not make it to Yerushalayim. So in the cities, and there those say you cannot keep Sukkot outside of Sukkah, outside of Yerushalayim. It's a lie. They said they made the booths on their houses and everywhere in the cities. C-I-T-I-E-S. Not just in Yerushalayim. In the gates, the water gates in every place, they made booths for the people. These are liars. They don't know Yah. For 900 years, they didn't keep it. And when they heard the reading of the Torah, everybody didn't have a Torah. Everybody couldn't just walk around reading out of the Torah, Yisrael. And so when the Kohen began to read, and those of that order, when they began to read, one read a while, then the other one would read. And when they heard in the place whereby this great Moed of Yah, the proclamation was made, go. Go to your cities, build booths. This is let's celebrate this unto Omariah. In verse 18, also day by day, from the first day to the last day, from the first day to the last day, he read in the book of the Torah, and they kept the feast 7 days, and on the eighth day was a solemn assembly according to that manner. They kept Sukkot. They had not kept it for 900 years. It's in the book, Yisrael. It's in the book. It's all prelude to the coming or the second chance, as we would call it. Yahshua is assurance for us all. And although they did it in ignorance and their sin prevented them, when the truth was spoken, they obeyed that. So the truth is spoken, we just keep the Pesach of Yah by examining ourselves and washing ourselves and cleansing ourselves, Yisrael. We have a sure word here in the Torah. I want to close from this. I kind of rushed through this, but one day Yah's will. Who knows? My Ach Shimri may take this up. Zakin Rabia, Zakin Birmi, all of, come on, my young Ach, to teach this in a more precise way. Because it would take me 3 or 4 months to teach this. Because I got to explain every verse. And I got to show the details that correlate with that verse in Chronicles, what it says in the Renewed Covenant and other places in the book. I can do that, but I just don't have the time to do it. You understand? I give you the format. You can take it from there. Listen, this is what I want to reassure you all with tonight in the book of Gilead. Revelation, chapter 1, verse 5. How are we washed? How are we kahat or kabas? How are we cleansed? Rahat, Zochin Ramiya taught on that at what time? He taught on Kabbats, the fuller of the work of the fuller. But it says in Revelation chapter 1, verse 5, and from Yahshua HaMashiach, who is the faithful witness, he is the faithful witness of the Pesach, is he not? He is the witness of Yah's truth, and the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth, to him. To him, Yisra'iyah, that loved us. That loved us. And Rahatz washed us from our sins in his own blood. He has washed us. We don't have to be strangers of the Pesach of the truth of Yah. He has washed us in his own blood. In his own blood. Even though our hands are filthy, he has washed us in his own blood. So there is no need for a second chance. We have the first offering that is pure of Yah. He has washed us in his own blood. We are washed by the dam of Yahshua HaMashiach. So all we do is examine ourselves and know our sins, confess them, and then the prayer of our own prayer shall heal us. That's our assurance. He has washed us. He has cleansed us, Yisrael. Yeah, he is the one that has rahats. Revelation 7:14. Yokohan said, and I said to him, Sir, Yah, you know. And he said to me, to the Melach, Yah, the messenger of Yah, These are those, Revelation 7:14. These are they which came out of great sorrow, great tribulation, great trials and affliction, and have washed their robe and made themselves Laban by the dam of Yeshua HaMashiach. That we have washed our clothing, our keli, our garment of Sadiq by the dam of Yeshua HaMashiach. And that's why Kepha says, not my feet only, but wash me, Yeshua. Those men that they came, they had touched the dead body. Our sins touch us. We are dead in trespasses in our sin, but we're cleansed by this dam of Yeshua HaMashiach. So we don't have to wait till next month, the second month. We keep it in the first month, Yisra'iyah. We don't have to wait 900 years. We hear the reading of the Torah and remind us and our children to keep the Mo'adim of Yah. Here's one that I want to show us all how we're going to do this. In the book of Ibram, the book of Hebrews, this is how we're going to do it. We're going to keep ourselves prepared and ready only this way. We have to do this. Hallelujah. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 22. Shaul commands us, Hebrews 10, 22. Let us draw near as we come to this time with a true love, with a true heart, in full assurance of imuna, of faith, of imuna, having our lamb, just like the blood was sprinkled, having our levim sprinkled from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. And this pure water is the word, the Torah of Yah, that wash and cleanse us from all of our sins and our wickedness. There's only one Pesach. There's only one. And even though the ignorance of Yisra'iyah for 900 years, Pesach for a long time, they didn't keep it. And not only did they keep a second Pesach, but they kept a third Pesach. They kept a third Matzvah. They celebrated the greatness of Yah's deliverance with singing, dancing, and eating. So let us celebrate from our levim, from our hearts collectively as one, celebrate the riches of Yah's truth and rejoice and eat and drink. We eat the living Torah. We drink from the fountain of life, Yeshua HaMashiach. Rejoice in the abundance of Yah's riches. I'm going to close. May Yah strengthen our hearts. As I said, who knows, one of these, ask Simeon why you don't teach anymore. But you are, I'll give you this and you can teach it in a more profound manner than my discombobulated effort tonight. I wanted to just teach that to us, Yisra'iyah, as we shall gather on the eve of the 25th to celebrate the Pesach, the Matzvah of Yah, and it's going to be a wonderful time. Yah's will, I will have everything ready. The process will not go like it did last year. We're going to have a great time. We shall dress and rejoice and sing and dance, and our little ones shall sing and dance and rejoice, and it will continue on the next day as we will have an immersing. We will have all that ready for you. So let us rejoice. We'll cleanse only one Pesach, and although in our ignorance we've forgotten, we can get back to where He wants us to be. Just like Hezekiah, he said, I know it's the second month, but we got to do this thing. And not only are we going to do a two, we're going to do a three. We're going to do it twice. Not on the second one, but it was the third one. What about the third Pesach? Like this is these are doctrines that are based upon the ignorance of men that think they're wise in their own conceit, and they're not wise. You understand? That's why we need men like the Ezra and the Nehemiah to build the walls, to build the strength of the assurance of the structure of Yah's house. That's what we need, Yisra'iyah. That's what we need. And a strong man, he doesn't need to be told he's strong. He knows he's strong. He knows he's strong. He doesn't need to be told that. Hallelujah. And that's what we need, messengers of great strength to tell us the truth that we may walk and that live in Torah. May the riches of Yah rest upon you, all you that have joined us. May He strengthen you. May He cause your heart to rejoice in the abundance of His riches and Yahshua. Come on, Arzachin Yaramiya. As He come, He will close us up. May Yah bless you all. May He strengthen Kol Yisra'iyah. with great abundance in Yahshua's name.
Hallelujah. We do barak you tonight, Yisrael. Those that listen by Viv live stream, those that come and gather with us, let us do as Rayak, as the Torah commands us to do, Yisrael. As we prepare ourselves, we make our minds, we make our lives ready. And as as Rat was speaking, Yisrael, it just comes to my mind that, you know, even those that have that are sick, when they go to the hospitals and things like that, they're turned away. People turn away because they don't have insurance. They don't have the monies. There are places that are just for the wealthy that they go and not for anyone else. But yet, on this paycheck, Yah has allowed anyone, any Israelite, any of us, Yisrael, to come and to be partakers of this paycheck. He has not turned any of us away, Yisrael, because the Dam of Yahshua has been shed, and it cleanses us all, that we are able and makes us able to make these preparations and to be ready for Yahweh's paycheck. Hallelujah. So I brought Yahweh for that tonight. My love is fat. I am excited. I am ready. Hallelujah. For this feast day for Pesach. So let us keep our hearts. Let us watch ourselves, Yisrael, and make the proper preparations that we can come, that we can gather, that we can be together. Those that are listening, come on. Hallelujah. To the Pesach of Almighty Yahweh. Let us stand to our feet, Yisrael. Hallelujah. Let us shub. Let us turn to Yerushalayim. Abba Yahweh, we do barak you. Abba Yahweh, for your truth, for your reassurance in Yahshua HaMashiach. We just ask tonight, Abba Yahweh, you will give your beloved, you will give us rest tonight as we have labored this week, Abba Yahweh. And as we also make preparations for your Shabbat day, Almighty Yahweh. 6 days we labor, and on your Shabbat, the seventh day we shall make preparations to rest, Abba Yahweh. We ask that your Melechim, that your messengers will protect Kol Yisrael. You will take those that have come from afar and from near home safely tonight. In all things we do barak you, we give you todah in the precious name of Yahshua HaMashiach, we do declare, hallelujah, 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 Yahweh, Yah barak ko Yisrael, hallelujah.